Warning, I am not a professional mastering engineer, so take everything I say in this video with a grain of salt. I do feel like the masters I've been making for my tracks don't sound bad compared to the pros. Now, one of the coolest things when you are in charge of the mix and master is that you can watch videos with a bunch of tips and get to use them in a song. It's such a great experience and it's very rewarding as well. And the first plugin in this chain is the Ozone Imager, and I'm utilizing a tip I learned from Lucas Prestoli's TikTok. In this TikTok, what he does is he opens up the mid stereo field while narrowing down the super high frequencies. Now, when it comes to working on music, we have a stereo image. And if you don't know what that is, pretty much think of it like this. Okay, we have the center, which sounds like this. On a vector scope, it's gonna look like a single straight line. And when you hear it on headphones, it's gonna sound like it's coming from the center. So that's one part of the stereo image. The other part that you have is gonna be the sides. Now, side information will usually sit like this. If you notice, you can hear a little bit of low end, but you hear a lot of reverb, you hear a lot of delay, and you hear some synth sounds. Now, you can create width in your track by panning stuff, by utilizing stereo enhancement, by adding voices to a synth. Once you get to the mastering phase, this is where Lucas Prestoli's tip comes in pretty clutch, okay? So what we're gonna do is we're gonna make everything below 100 or 200 hertz be more centered. The width, the middle one, is actually widened, and this allows a lot of the center mid frequencies to come out. Now, if we were to hear that, the center mids usually where the body of your vocals gonna lie, where the body of your synths are gonna lie. It also makes the track sound a little fuller, so now let's get rid of it. Okay, listen to the reverb and the brass shot. Now we'll get rid of it. But we lower this down to maybe around 40. You don't have to go too crazy with it. From there, the very high frequencies, we centered them. And then we have this one, which I gave a bit of more width to. Accentuates it. From there, I always utilize an EQ8 to help me get rid of low end at specific sections of the song. You can see that it's a very busy portion here. Now, the idea for this is just contrast. One of the things that I embarked on back in the day, like in 2016, 2017, was songwriting. Why doesn't my music sound good? And one of those things is contrast, the feeling that there's change, big enough changes to make the listener feel like the song is going somewhere. So usually in intros, I will have the low cut there so that it sounds like this versus like this. Now, the reason I personally do this is, again, I just wanna make every part of the song a moment. Let's say that my listener is listening to the intro. The moment the bass comes in needs to be a moment. You know, that's something that I can hold out on and give to the listener. And I use it strategically, again, to create change. Now you can see here that there's a lot of movement on it. You know you want me. Take me on a ride. And that is because this is my breakdown. So again, I want to have the low end there for the Reese. Everything that you do makes me feel alive. This guy here. I wanted to have that low end. Then we have the build up. From there, I have this Ozone 9 Match EQ, which again, I'll say this. I've had mastering engineers tell me this is wrong, but to this day, I still use it because I find that it sounds good for me. Now, the idea of the Ozone 9 Match EQ is that you're gonna pretty much feed it a reference of what you would like to your song to sound like, let's say. Can I ask you, was it something I did? Again, you're gonna put this plugin on the channel with that track and you hit capture, and it captures the frequency, and then you go on yours and hit capture. From there, you're gonna use the fine tune. See, as I'm adding this, I'm adding more mids. I'm cutting a bit of highs here. You can see I'm cutting a bit of low end. So you got this going, and then you can also smoothen this, because again, if you go super spectral, you're going to have a lot of peaks like that, which might sound unnatural for your track. Now I have this automating for the breakdown only, as I love the way the drop sounded on this track in particular. So there was no need for an Ozone 9 match EQ. Everything that you do makes me feel alive. You can see if I put it up, but we don't want that. We bypass it. Now, one of the dopest things about mastering your own music is that you get to indulge in buying and trying out plugins. And for this one, I wanted to do something new, because for my previous tracks, I've always been using the Sand Compressor from Acoustica, which is an SSL recreation. For this one, I wanted to get something dumpy. So I went online and started Googling what's the best compressor for character and punch. And almost every single forum talked about the API 2500 being that. So I said, okay, you know, Waves is being a dick. Your boy don't want to support them. So what's a plugin company that has done a good remake of it? Now, when they say this compressor is dumpy, it is dumpy. So the way that I usually set up a compressor, here you can see our VU meter. Now I'm looking at the red, not at the black, because I'm looking at my gain reduction, and I'm looking for at least the needle to dance and head back to zero. Some people say try and get at the least amount of gain reduction, but I've been really intrigued by these mastering and mixing engineers that push their compressors really hard, but it still sounds good. So it's like they're shaping the master. A lot of times with these dance tracks, what's really dictating that compressor is going to be the low end of the kick hitting. Doom, doom. That's why you see this thing just going up and down. Yep. So for this one, I wanted to experiment with the idea of maybe not having the kick drive the compression too much, but allowing some of the top elements too. So we can bring in this sidechain high pass filter, which just cuts the lows as the sound enters. It doesn't cut it from what's being produced or what you're going to hear. It cuts it before it enters the compressor. So the compressor reacts to a signal that doesn't have as much low end as the track. Okay. From there, most people say to have an attack of 30 milliseconds, as this allows the kick to pass through the compressor so it doesn't get squashed too much. But there's been people like Ian Bluestone that I've watched where they make the kick be loud as possible in the song so that they can compress it into the song. So again, experimentation is key, but if you're trying to play it safe, then 30 milliseconds attack is usually fine. And I usually have my release be fast for these. From there, we have the knee on the compressor, which is soft, medium, and hard. And the best way I can explain the knee is for hard, you know, the compression is sudden, which usually you want to use for more like drums, percussive stuff. And soft knees, the compression is gradually added. Compression. Now, let me show you what this means in a visual format just so that it makes a little bit of sense. Here we have the Ableton compressor. Now, notice what happens when I have the knee set to 0.0 dB. Which means that we have a very hard knee. And notice that as I move the threshold down, there is no gain reduction here. Now watch what happens if I increase the knee. Even though I'm not touching threshold, the compression is being applied slowly. So if I wanted a compressor that is super dumpy, I wanted character, then I want a compressor with a high, medium, hard knee. Okay, from there, let's see how it sounds. You can hear how the kick is fucking hitting now. Now, is this good or bad? Well, that's the thing. You know, with compression, some people don't want it to, you don't want to hear it. And that means that you want to be transparent, that you want it to not sound like you're compressing at all. And to some people, they want a compressor that has a lot of character, which, again, when done improperly, it can sound kind of newbie because you hear the compression. But when done in a way where it accentuates the song and it's doing its intended purpose, I feel that that's good compression. So for this one, just to be safe, and because I'm a very, I overthink stuff, we're going to put it in medium. So the next thing we have is the utility. Now, again, this auto filter and utility probably should go somewhere else, but again, the song is done, done mistakes, let's get over with. The width is actually used to make, again, the track sound like it's more centered than wide, as we talked about when we had the Ozone 9 imager. So as we approach a buildup, we want to utilize the width to kind of narrow it a bit. This is a trick I learned from Mal P or Maurice West. He talked about it in a video. And ever since then, I've utilized it in every song that I worked on and that I've mixed and mastered for people. If I overdo it, it's narrowing it down. Thinning it in the stereo image. You know, and then it opens up, right? So that's the idea. Now, I wanted to try a bunch of different techniques, and this is the last one that I saw, which I'm going to keep using, and it's going to be clipper to limiter. I want you to do is look at the meter here. I want you to look at the peak meter. That's going to be the very dark green one that you see. So you can see that the mix average, I'm around 12 with it, but you can see that it jumps here and there. Up. So what I'm trying to do with the clipper is I'm trying to shave off some of those peaks, some of those doom jumps that you see, and I'm trying to do it in a very transparent way. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm using the Black Salt clipper because it's very easy to use. You can also use the K-Clip 3 from Kazrog, and then T-Rex has one as well. And I like this one though because it's more visual. And it doesn't take up as much CPU. So from there, this is what we do. Move it down. Now, again, I'm trying not to get too much of an audible change. Again, I want it to be very transparent. As we look over here, you got the jumps. Now let's do it with the clipper on. And you can see that now we're not going up on it, right? Now, this is very important because if this clipper wasn't here to begin with, this limiter would have to account for that. And that information will reach this limiter, which again is my limiter for loudness. And it's going to cause my attenuation to spike up. So now is the last step in the mastering phase. And in this step, we're going to try and get to our desired LUFS. So for me, for these kind of tracks, -7, -8 seems to be the norm. Now, again, I don't want to go over 2 dB of gain reduction as this is going to start to deteriorate the signal. But if you choose to do it yourself, that is totally fine. As a lot of the big tracks out there, you'll notice they get really loud. And the ones that tend to do it are also the more simplistic tracks because there's not a lot of information. From here, this is probably one of the hardest parts. Because as we get this loud, obviously we're going to think it sounds good. But what I recommend you do is go to the bottom right and set a unity gain up. This is going to be a button here that is going to pretty much think of it, keep the volume the same, but it's going to introduce limiting. So you get to hear what limiting is doing to the sound rather than the loudness that comes from it. From there, I want to introduce the gain up until I hit my desired LUFS or my, again, my set attenuation, which is going to be gain reduction on some. Okay, so I'm around 2 dB of gain attenuation, and we're around -7.3, so I'm going to push it a little bit more. Again, I have the unity gain on. If I take that off, brace your ears. Okay. But again, we're going to set it so that we can make better educated decisions. Think of it as you have no beer goggles. Okay, so now from here, this is the part that, I'm not going to lie to you guys, tends to be a little bit more subjective because the way a Pro L2 works, it has different algorithms, and then you're going to set up your look ahead, attack and release. There's a couple of things you definitely want to avoid with it, but to be honest, either one can be right or wrong on how you set it up, as long as it sounds good. But if you have a good mix and you've been doing everything right in the mastering process, this is the easiest part. So we're going to have a bunch of algorithms that we can pick. I usually recommend going through them as you set stuff up and switching on and off and going with the one that you think sounds good. I also recommend maybe making this a 3-day thing so that you can come back and experiment with it. However, you want to be the type of guy that lives in the moment and just pick whichever and be happy. So again, if you want transparent, you can, punchy, dynamics. Now for this track, again, it was all about being punchy and aggressive. So I'm going to go with aggressive for this one. From there, we have the look ahead. So in this one, you got to ask yourself if you are the type of guy that likes to play it safe or likes to go for all of it. So if you like to go for all of it, then use short look ahead times, which are going to allow you to get louder because you're not telling the limiter to be super protective and look for incoming short peaks that might cause the limiter to really just overload. And instead of worrying about that, it's going to worry about getting you loud. Okay, so low look aheads will achieve that, while higher ones is playing it more safe. Essentially, you get beefier drums, but you lose the snappiness in the drums. It's a good way to look at it. So, you know, since I'm the type of guy that overthinks everything, I'm going to put it maybe around the middle here. Okay, so you can see I'm already louder by using the aggressive algorithm. So let's lower it down a bit. Again, I still want to be nice at my 2. And there we go. From there, we have our attack and release, which is completely different than a compressor. The attack is pretty much saying how fast we're going to have the release start to set in. So usually a lower attack is a lot safer because you want the release to activate soon and you have more control, versus a higher attack is a little bit more dangerous. So again, if we know dangerous means louder, then maybe we can be somewhere in the middle with it. Now with this, again, this is why the unity gain is very important, because I can tell you this, but if you don't know how it's going to sound like, then it doesn't really matter. So what we can do is start to set the attack and hear how the signal reacts to it. Let's push it a little harder. So from here, we have a release, and this is probably going to be the most important knob in any limiter that you are going to utilize. Usually a shorter release means that the release is going to boom be fast, which means you get more snappier, more punchier transients, versus a longer release means it's a lot safer since, again, you're holding on for longer with the limiter. And this will give you more sustain, and it will also make the compressor sound cleaner. But again, you are losing character. And as you become a better producer, you're going to want to have character in your music, because again, a clean mix is dope, but we all want that dirty, tasteful master. So let's go slow with the release, because again, this track has so much drum in it that we need a short one. So here we go. From there, we have the channel linking. And to be honest, guys, I don't really mess with this a lot. My knowledge of this is, again, if you have a left or right, and let's say on the left side you have the sound that comes in and needs to be limited, then the right side will also get limited at the same time. That's my understanding of this, but to be fair, I'm not too sure on it. So I would encourage you guys, if you're interested in this guide, to go look at more tutorials. But usually for me, if it sounds good, it sounds good, and I usually leave it the way that it's set up. Okay, so from there now, if I have a short look ahead time and it's not long, then I always recommend to turn on true peak limiting and set oversampling. So we'll see if my CPU lets me do this. So again, since we are going with a bit more of a heavy, aggressive compression, then I am going to choose to oversample at either 2x or 4x. Now from there, don't get confused with the higher the number, the cleaner the compressor sounds, the limiter, or the better it sounds. In fact, sometimes 2x will sound better than 4x. So experiment, and again, keep using the unity gain in order to gauge it. And once you have everything set up, you can take it off and enjoy your loud track. See, like 4x feels like it's too much. And 2x feels like it's more free. Okay. Now from here, this is the last thing I want to show you guys. Before, I used to automate with my utility and utilize the gain from my utility. And then I would lower the volume down for the breaks and make it louder for the drops. But now what I've been doing is utilizing the limiter to do this. I'll go to the limiter's gain, Shaw Automation, it's almost the exact same thing, except this time I'm using a limiter to do it. So the way it's going to work is simple. We're going to go into the track. We're going to put some coordinate points. I recommend that you set them up at the drops as it is from the start. I want there to be a change in dynamics as I approach that drop. So what I'm going to do is go in my limiter, set another one here, which is the buildup. And as we approach closer and closer to the drop, we're actually going to decrease the volume by a few dB. Again, we don't want it to be too apparent. So again, just checking that volume. Maybe we can go a little more. Okay, I'm going to go more. Okay, now we can hear the change. So that's a little too much. Let's just go a few dB. Now, personally, me, I like to have buildups in the middle parts of my drop. So for this buildup, I actually need to do this automation or it's going to sound really bad in the song. So what I'm going to do is do this here. A little more. Now for the breaks, I usually like to use the like little effects and stuff, like little stops, so that I can actually reduce the volume with an effect. So here we have a crash. Lower the volume. Okay, there we go. The new techniques that I learned again was utilizing the Ozone 9 imager, not to make the high frequencies be wider, but to make the mid frequencies be wider. The second technique I utilized was a new compressor called the Lindell SBC, which is an API 2500. Now, I'm still not adept at using it, but I love the way that it made the track sound dumpier for me. And it's just something that, again, sometimes you want a transparent compressor, which just means that you don't really hear the compression, and sometimes you want it to be heard. It really does depend on the kind of track you are making. From there, the clipper to the limiter is a new technique I'm using, and I think I'm gonna keep using this one for years to come. I mean, I get some people say, why would you clip it? You just compress something. But again, a lot of times peaks will come through the compressor because again, our ratio is 3:1. It's not really that high up, so there's gonna be like transient peaks that are gonna get through. So again, guys, I'm not a professional mastering engineer. I'm just a guy that wants to share this knowledge with people because that is my passion, that is my muse, and that is what brings me happiness. And if you wanna support the channel, you can head over to evilsounds.com. You can find all of my sound design work. If you guys have any thoughts on what I did or you wanna give constructive criticism, I'm totally fine with that. You can leave a comment down below. I will welcome it. Now, if you guys wanna see the mastering chain I did for my track, Can I Ask You, which I think sounds a bit better, but that's due to the mix, then you can check out this video here. On this one, I go over the master I did for that one and how it came to be.